Hello everyone, welcome to the ICA and to Culture Now. Thank you very much for coming today. Culture Now is our series of lunchtime talks with key figures from the contemporary culture. I'm really delighted to introduce our speakers today. George Stone, who's currently a sci-fi writer and a regular contributor to Radio 4's Bespoken Word. He has won awards for radio and TV commercials. His alter ego performance poet, Alfred Lord Telecom, appeared at Glastonbury in 2011. Rocky Morton, who's directed a number of music videos and commercials and is co-founder of the advertising company Morton, Jankel, Xander Productions. He is also co-director of feature films Dead on Arrival and Super Mario Brothers, and also co-created the Emmy Award-winning title sequence for the NBC show Friday Night Videos. And Annabel Jankel, who also co-created Max Headroom and has since worked extensively in film and advertising, directing commercials for Coca-Cola, Bud Light, AOL, Bacardi, Hallmark and Greenpeace. Her film and television work includes the music documentary Live from Abbey Road and critically acclaimed film adaptation of the novel Skylake. So the speakers will have a discussion around the virtual personality Max Headroom, and then shortly after that we'll be screening Max Headroom 20 minutes into the future. So thank you very much to our speakers. Thank you all for coming, and I'll hand over to George now.
Thank you. It was the 80s. The future had arrived, and it had a blonde rinse, a mad stare, and it acted like an android. Its name was Margaret Thatcher. And it had been swept to power on a tsunami of garbage, unburied bodies, and the Sex Pistols. And once Ronald Reagan had been persuaded onto the gimp hook, the apocalypse seemed inevitable. It was only a matter of time. We were surrounded by signs. They all said, Max Headroom. And the car park industry were furious when we nicked their sign. They got into a terrible huff and changed virtually all of the ones that said Max Headroom to Max Height. It cost millions. If we cannot laugh, we are not free. And if we are not free, we might as well be expensive. How expensive exactly? The Max Headroom adventure cost the Coca-Cola company $800 million. Catch the wave and wave goodbye. But that was later. What you had initially was the three of us. Rocky Morton, Annabel Jankel, and me, George Stone, figuring out what to do with this fab new medium called the pop promo. We had a title. The show was going to be called Max Headroom. We knew it was going to be about the language of television and point a camera at television itself. There was no such thing as media studies then or digital creativity, so we were making it up as we went along, talking about subliminal advertising, multi-channel TV, and news as showbiz, and the ideas which would later become blipverts. Then Rocky said, I think he should be a man, and he should be computer generated. I didn't believe then, and I still don't believe, we'll ever be able to program an AI. So the film you're going to see, in a moment or so, is the answer to the question, where did Max Headroom come from? Looking back, it seems extraordinary that we got away with it. And that's how it felt at the time. But first of all, let's have a look at Max Headroom in action, with a few clips from the Channel 4 series, The Max Headroom Video Show.
Don't you sit still and try to watch.
Watch what?
Max Headroom, it's his last show.
Oh yeah, who's he?
Who's he? Well, it's this bloke. Sort of bloke. Well, half and half, if you know what I mean.
Oh yeah, sounds great.
All right. If you must know, he's a computer-generated microcosm of the television age, incorporating a fusion of visual and verbal originality to represent the inherent diversity of the all-round TV personality. And he plays pop videos and all.
Oh, that Max Headroom.
Good morning, Sydney. Good afternoon, Los Angeles. Good evening, England. And it's the Max Headroom Show. Tonight on the show, it's more pop videos. Max gives away prizes. Max looks back, forward, and meets the stars with his old buddy Sting. He's turned down a pro-am golf tournament to be here with you all tonight. He is the man of the moment. He is Mr. TV himself, Max Headroom.
Thank you. And it's on with the show. And it's Max gives away prizes time on our brand new game show. Get excited!
Control.
How about all that?
Who could forget this? Or that? And don't forget, later on I'll be talking to Nick Kershaw on the telephone. And who could forget opening time because of this? Or that.
Hey, you! Don't watch that! Watch this! Watch this! Watch this! This is this! Watch this! This is the heavy, heavy monster sound!
And remember burning the beans because of this? And what about this?
Mozart. That's my tip for the top.
This.
Sopranos, altos, you name it.
Or this little humdinger. Dinger.
And we're next up with... Hey, look, can you kids go play...
Or this little humdinger. This. This.
Why are the only funny lines on this show the ones behind me? I'd rather tap dance. An Irishman.
Zappa!
Thomas!
Are you like a window?
It's a pity, because he could have had a big hit with that.
Four.
Straight jacket.
Annabel, I'm Rocky. That show actually went out exactly like that. We didn't edit that for this presentation. That's how it was screened on Channel 4.
Do you want to sit here?
No, it's fine. George.
Cool. So here we all are.
the ones to blame for that.
I just knew this would happen. I just knew it. Okay, here we go.
We knew the future.
Right, I got it now. Yeah, I just wanted to get the first of the job. Thanks, George.
Cool. See, we knew the future would be broken at the time. And of course it is. It's, Well, there were three heads that did it, actually. Three heads and one idea. And it was very interesting when we first got together because we found there were a huge number of things that we had in common. You were at art school and everything, and I was a science fiction writer.
Well, we just formed, Annabel and I just formed our first production company called Cucumber, and we were doing mainly animation kind of things. In fact, the first things we were doing was making films to be back projected behind punk bands, and that sort of led into making music videos. And then ultimately, you know, being asked to create a show for Channel 4 to link these music videos together. I've got an example of the sort of work that we were doing at the time. Should I stick it on to that? This is a video we did for Elvis Costello at the time. There's a clip of it.
That was the green images that you saw there. I mean, there was no kind of computer graphics at the time of this. You were just filming straight off an oscilloscope, weren't you?
That was state-of-the-art computer graphics at the end of that.
I think it was...
When we went in to create Max Headroom, it was a fully CGI computer image of himself. That was it. That was what we were looking at.
I think we did that at the London School of Economics?
No, it was at a college somewhere.
It was one of the universities because there was no facility other than university facilities to actually go and shoot
something. The only way we could create it was the end image was on an oscilloscope, that's why it's green, and then we had a 16mm camera shooting frame by frame, shooting every image off the oscilloscope.
You'll see in the film a bit later that there are some things which are called which look like computer graphics. In point of fact, I think it was you who came up with the term SCAT, which stands for
Simulated
Computer Animation Technique,
which basically means it looks like it came from a computer, but of course it was done in a traditional way by a fantastic man called Peter Tuppy. You must give him a
Peter Tuppy was it helped me with a lot of these. Computer-generated techniques, and we got a lot of work from the advertising industry because I convinced them that we were using computer technology, but in fact what we were doing was we were filming objects, like if we wanted a cup to be computer-generated, we'd paint it white and put black lines on it, and then we'd shoot it frame by frame on a turntable, and then print those frames back out under a rostrum camera and make the lines glow, so the advertising agency would think they were getting this incredible high-tech image. But it was all done in a dark room with Peter Tuppy's rostrum camera.
It was a world of fraud and artifice, really. It was bluff from the very outset.
It was, yes.
And as I said at the beginning, we were terrified of being found out because we sort of knew what we were doing. We knew we were subverting television. We knew that we were kind of going to irritate people and couldn't believe we were bloody well going to get away with it. Today, I don't think you could you? And I don't think they'd let sort of the hooligans of the age we were.
Well, no, but I don't think anybody knew what was possible, no. Whereas now everything seems.
I didn't know
very
how dangerous it was, yeah. That was the thing.
Yeah.
It's such a mystery to everybody. And then what happened was that Channel 4 had just started up, and they didn't have very much money, so they were looking for cheap programming ideas. And one of the ideas was videos which were being produced at the time, which were being given away free by the record companies to promote their bands. And they had this genius idea of linking them all together in some way and creating a really cheap show. So
cheap.
Yeah. Cheap. So they were looking around who could create this show, and they came to the three of us, and I actually thought it was a really boring idea. You know, I thought it's just really, you know, stupid and boring to just link music videos together. And I thought, well, maybe we should go with the whole idea of it being boring. I was thinking, well, what's the most boring way to present a show? And I thought the talking head, you know, like the news, and that would really piss off all the kids that like the music videos. So there'd be some kind of energy going there. And then George came up with the name, The Max Headroom Show. And that inspired me to think, well, maybe Max Headroom, maybe that's the name of this talking head.
Prepare yourself for an epiphany.
So then I was searching for what would he look like? What would he talk like? What would be the incarnation of it? And then I was looking through a book that was published by the pop artist Richard Hamilton. And he had a collection of images in this book. And one of them that inspired me was this guy. And it's from a B-movie called The Man with the...
Atom brain.
Yeah, the creature with the atom brain. And I thought, well, that's Max Headroom right there. And then the scar on his skull, I thought, well, obviously, you know, he
there
was
late. There has to be a reason for that.
There has to be a reason for that. So, and I came up with this idea, he was late for his show, and he somehow got topped and had this accident. And then in order to get him on the show that night, they had to download his brain and have a computer-generated facsimile of himself to get him on the show. And Annabel and I showed this image to George.
And I fell in love.
Yeah.
It was extraordinary. Also, as another indication, because we're going to try and be pushing an idea at you through the course of this, that we are remarkably prescient and can foresee the future. So you're looking there at the face, too, of a future president of the United States. Because he does look a bit like George Bush, doesn't he, really, after the operation. But seeing that picture, it was a complete inspiration. Because we were then stuck with the question of, where does he come from? Where could this creature come from? And, yes, as I said, we... is he computer generated? And this was something that irritated the hell out of you, because it was something that I felt was very important. Can we program, is it possible to program a human consciousness, something that would actually pass the Turing test, would pass as human? And I didn't believe then, and as I said earlier, I don't believe now that that is the case. That we will ever be able to produce a viable AI. I mean, there's a lot of people who claim that we will be able to, but I think that language is the most complicated thing we do, it's the most interesting thing we do, and language kind of defines itself. Language produces thought, and thought produces language. So in order to get this Max Headroom character, we had in some way to devise a technology which would enable us to take a snapshot of a working human brain.
But that was down the road. I mean, what we had to do was sell the idea to Channel 4.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. with George's outline, we went and pitched it to Channel 4. Not just the show that we were going to link with a guy that was going to look something like this, but also we had an idea for how he became this character, and they loved the idea. And they said, what we want to do is make a film that you'll be seeing in a minute that explains his origin, and that will kick off the video series. But the trouble is, we don't have any money.
That was always the trouble.
Yeah, so our producer, Peter Wagg, was sent on a plane to America to get some money. And he took our showreel and George's treatment and went off to Hollywood. But on the way to Hollywood, he stopped off in New York and he had a meeting at HBO. It was his first meeting on American soil. And as soon as he pitched it to them, they said, don't leave your hotel room within 24 hours. We're going to get back to you. And they said, we want this show. We're going to pay for it. And he didn't even make it to Hollywood. So then he flew back with the cash in his pocket, and there we were. We, you know, were first-time filmmakers with this project that we were going to direct and create. So this is where we shot it, which is Becton Gasworks, which is where Kubrick shot Full Metal Jacket. It was a dismantled Victorian gasworks, which had the perfect dystopian kind of landscape for us. And we had a fantastic production designer called Mo Kane, who sort of created this amazing environment for us, because Annabel and I kind of knew what we wanted, but we didn't have the experience of feature filmmaking, even though it was a small film for television, an hour long. And we had a fantastic DP, Phil Mayhew, and we had a great AD called Chris Rose, who's here. He's right there. His hands up. And without him, we'd still be in Becton making this film if it wasn't for him. And we had a great editor as well called Michael Bradsell, and then Midge Ewer, who was, what was the name of his
Ultravox.
Ultravox, did the music, and he was a great collaborator. And then casting, really, which was the most important thing, obviously, was casting the right Max, and we found Matt Frewer, who really sort of took the sort of the kind of robot that we had into this incredible personality and gave it the humour and everything else.
And also had Stephen Berkoff was in the frame for a
while.
Well,
I spent a night at the Zanzibar trying to talk Stephen Berkoff into being Max
Headroom. Can you imagine Stephen Berkoff as Max Headroom? That would have been a different tip.
And actually, we did Stephen lots Berkoff of cocaine and alcohol. He did come back afterwards about 10 years later and say it was the worst move I ever did was not take that gig.
Yeah. So he didn't get the job. He went to Matt Frewer. And also, Theora, the girl in it, was played by Amanda Pays, and Nicholas Grace played the bad guy, which is the head of Network 23, who was superb. Morgan Shepherd played Blank Reg, which was this kind of like punk, sort of in the future, who's still a punk. You know, if it hadn't been for that fantastic cast, I mean, they were just incredible, weren't they? I mean, they just brought everything to life.
Punk will never die, by the way.
So then we shot the film, and as we were shooting the film, there were lots of screens in the film, as you'll see, where Max Headroom appears. But we didn't know what Max Headroom was going to look like. We had absolutely no idea at all. We were rushed into production, and we just had green screens on all the televisions. And the producers were getting more and more anxious as we came to the end of this film. We edited the entire film with no Max Headroom. The whole film was edited with just all blank screens and no dialogue for every time he appeared, because we couldn't figure out a way of creating a computer-generated character. Like, at the end of Accidents Will Happen, that was the state of the art. So we went through these phases of trying flat graphics and then animation. And we could have completely animated it, but we didn't have the money and we didn't have the time. And then we built a puppet, a sort of rubber puppet, and we were trying to manipulate this rubber puppet, and that didn't work at all. And then we tried makeup on the actor, and that just looked terrible. And then one day, I was thinking, well, there's got to be a way of using the human face. And I thought, well, if we use Matt's face, you know, there's everything on the human face. I mean, it is what it is. All we've got to do is make his face look like it's computer generated by degenerating it in some way, photographing it in some way. So we started to, we made a sculpture, we molded his face and made a sculpture of it, how it might look as a model if it was computer generated.
Well, we actually did, I mean, we came up with the idea that it should look like a mannequin, in fact, if you remember what we were talking
about.
Yeah,
it should look like primitive.
Like sculpting it in pieces so that it would actually have like a shop, almost like a shop window mannequin.
Yeah, and instead of getting a computer to manipulate it, we just have the actor.
Cheaper.
It's much cheaper. So that's what we did. And so we sculpted his face and then applied this prosthetics makeup to it.
and we had the plastic jacket made for him, and then he became Max. When we did this, we went out into the high street with him like that. It was really funny. We filmed a bit of that, and then when we set him up in the video studio, we had to light him in a very harsh way to create this, you know, as if a computer had lit it. So it was intensely harsh light, which started to sort of melt the rubber, and Matt would sweat inside of it. And as he's talking, we'd see dribbles of sweat coming through the makeup, which is quite ominous. But you know, that was it really. And then we filmed that on video, and then we keyed it into the green screen of the film.
While we're waiting, next time you're near the B section of a dictionary, look up blipvert, because it's very comforting to know that we actually managed to add a word to the English language. The word is blipvert. You'll find out about it later, but I was just taking the advantage of this small commercial break just to communicate this. And
now I'm actually making blipverts. Because when I do, I still make commercials. Mm-hmm. So, and what the agencies ask me for now are these, you know, small little blipverts. They call them blipverts.
Yeah, they do.
For the internet.
Mm, yeah.
I mean, I'm actually, you know, making them now.
I did some experimental blipverts a few years ago for a company we did, and they were 5-second long radio commercials, which I think were really short. I mean, you know, the company went broke. I mean, but it didn't actually. It was a raging success. But,
so then we made the film, and then it was shown on Channel 4, and it just became this overnight success. It, you know, the press were really hungry for information about it, and I remember having an interview with the press and saying to them, well, actually it's a man in makeup, it's not really computer generated. And they didn't believe me. They said, no, you're lying, it's computer generated, it can't be a man in a mask, because they'd never seen anything like it. I mean, now you can obviously tell, but back then they were convinced that it really was, and they thought that I was just pulling the wool over their eyes. So I went with that notion. In the end, I used to say to them, well, in Japan, they've had a computer-generated man reading the news for years. You know, this is nothing that new, you know. And it was all believed. And then after the success in the UK, of course, it went to HBO in America because they'd paid for it, and that's what they wanted to do, is show it on HBO. And eventually it got picked up by ABC, and they made it into how many shows that they make, like 20.
No, I still haven't seen the 14.
Yeah. I mean, the American version of the show and the British version of the film, of the first film, and the British version of the film. Was there any similarity between the two at all?
Yes.
Yes.
I think the only time in history a film has ever been copied frame by frame, which is what they did in America. They took our film, and they recast it, except for Matt Frewer and Amanda Pays. They recast the entire thing. They kept the same script, more or less, but tweaked it for the American audience. They built sets identical. They lit it identically. And they just recreated the exact same film that you're about to see in America. It was
I don't think they could do that these days.
Yeah.
I think copyright law was probably...
It wouldn't be allowed.
Yeah, it was a pre-copyright.
I can't think in history of another film being copied like this. And then, you know, he became this huge hit. It was on the front page of Newsweek magazine, and it was everywhere. And eventually, he got caught by the eye of an advertising agency.
Oh.
And yes. They were launching a new product.
Well, it was one of those moments of corporate hubris, if you think about it. Can you imagine the meeting? You're sitting around, you're in Atlanta, and you're an executive of the Coca-Cola company. And you've just been to the bathroom, had a couple of sniffs, and you come back with a really good idea. What we're going to do is we're going to change the taste of Coca-Cola. Loved by millions, we're going to change it. We're going to change it. And it's going to be different from here on in, because different is good. And that's what happened. That's what they did. And Max Headroom was the face of that. That's why it cost $800 million. That's why it cost two CEOs and two entire floors of marketing department in Atlanta. Yes, it was...
He killed it off. He killed New Coke.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That was the crowning glory, really.
It was.
It was perfect.
Yes, catch the wave and wave goodbye.
Yeah.
But, I was gratified by that in a curious way. It's good to know that the thing had a power to compel.
All paid for by Pepsi.
Yes, exactly. All paid for by Pepsi, and of course, the Max Headroom meme, if we believe in memes, sort of extended itself. And as it says here, Chicago was blanked out by a man. Chicago is a town in Illinois, and they have television there, like they do here. And the television in Chicago, Illinois, for a large number of channels, was blanked out for a few minutes by what you see here, this man in a Max Headroom mask. We don't know why he did it. We don't know whether he was a fan. He hasn't been in touch, but I'm not sure if there's royalties due to him or not. But if he wants to get in touch, if he's in the audience, make yourself known after the showing. And of course, the idea was picked up too, and this was immensely gratifying, when Gary Trudeau, who does the Doonesbury cartoons, decided that there was a similarity between Max and a president called Ron.
The man with the atom brain.
The man with the atom brain. And so Ron Headrest, as you see him, became what Reagan was for the duration of his presidency, which again shows the extraordinary power of the idea and the fantastic people you have sitting here talking to you today. And of course, it lives on. Now, I can't remember names, but this man apparently has a name.
It's Anderson Cooper, 36, yeah.
Anderson Cooper, yes. This is The Line, this is CNN, this is Now. The Max Headroom meme continues to infect the television consciousness. Does it not?
Yeah, this brings us right up to date, I guess, the whole culture now. And you know, could this image really exist if it hadn't have been for dear old Max?
It's the lines and the steely gaze. Yeah. The steely gaze
it's
really...
It's incredible, the likeness, and the haircut and everything.
Exactly.
And the syllables are Edison Carter, Anderson Cooper.
Yeah. That's extraordinary. Yeah. That's wild.
It's got a Christian name and a surname.
Yeah. So yes, I don't know. Does anybody have any?
Yeah, we're going to have a Q&A now, I think.
Yeah, I mean, this is a Lego Max Headroom off the showing how just how far that goes. But if anybody has any questions, because we won't be doing. There's a question down there. Let's go straight to the lovely lady.
I remember. Sing my song now. I remember when it was at the ICA when you launched it.
Oh yes, you didn't mention that. Yes,
exactly.
Yeah.
Here somewhere or other.
Yes.
You launched it, but.
Can I just explain what that was so everybody knows? What that was. We did a show at the ICA here in the theatre, and it was called Max Headroom Patronizes the Arts. And the idea was we had was to a live Max Headroom show. So the way we did that, we had an outside broadcast truck parked outside in the Mall, and inside that truck we had Matt Frewer in all the makeup and lit, and then we had a camera pointed at him, which went through a video synthesizer, and his voice went through a separate audio synthesizer, so we could stutter his voice and take it up in register, and we could stop and start his image to make him stutter. And up on a big screen similar to this down in the theater, there was Max, and there was another camera looking out at the audience that fed back to the outside broadcast truck outside, and Matt Frewer could see people in the audience. So he would look at people in the audience, say, "You in the purple jacket," and start to insult them. And the audience literally freaked out because they'd never seen anything like this before. And it got heckled. People were throwing things at the screen. Half the audience walked out. Do you remember? It was like a complete... like mayhem, it was the anarchy.
It was art.
It was fantastic.
It was an installation.
It was.
And he introduced, and he did a live performance of the video show. So there was a band, it was the Pet Shop Boys.
First ever live gig.
Their first live gig, and he introduced the Pet Shop Boys, and then the screen went blank, and then they came on and did their gig.
I think the reason I remembered that was because what you were saying about how he tried to tell the journalist that he was really a man dressed up. But my recollection is that you both fostered the myth I mean,
no myth.
It was never quite clear, and nobody was quite sure, and it was certainly something you both fostered. I mean,
yeah.
The idea that Max Headroom was computer generated.
Well, that's the image that we created to convince the audiences that it was,
yes.
But we didn't
so
think
never,
that the press
yeah.
would believe it. We thought that that they would know that it was just a man in makeup.
With the exception of the members of the press who are here present, the press is generally thick.
It was around April Fool's Day as well, wasn't it? I seem to remember.
Really?
That's just too cruel. Too cruel.
You did sort of foster that, I think.
Yeah, I think it was fun to.
You kind of really caught up. You say that it was dangerous. I think you said, didn't you, George? How was it sort of dangerous? I mean, I can see. I mean, to me, it seems like. What's it called? Science fiction.
Mm-hmm.
It's like science fiction.
Science fiction, though, I mean, the point of science fiction isn't to predict a future, it's to examine what's going on now through slightly different spectacles, I think. I think what we were all interested in was what's now called, I think, the process of television. I mean, television isn't neutral. It's an active force with an agenda and a point of view and everything else. And in Max Headroom, we were examining that idea. And I don't think that had been examined before in the area of popular culture that we were working in. Something that says what you see on television isn't necessarily true. There's a book, which I found immensely useful, which I would refer anyone to, by Jacob J. Epstein, called News from Nowhere, which was early 80s, so before this came out. And it talks about the news process, and it asks questions like, when you see a man come out of a door and deliver a pronouncement to a set of cameras, all of that's a setup. It's all artifice. There is no accident. There aren't news crews now cruising around London looking for news stories. It's a cozy kind of conspiracy between the newsmakers and the news tellers. So just saying a bit more of that, I thought, was an interesting idea because it perhaps frees people up a bit. They don't think that what they're seeing is necessarily the truth. I mean, we're in a very different world now, of course, with Mr. Murdoch going through all the trouble he's going through. We're starting
that's
to question the process.
Dangerous.
Sorry? Yeah.
That's what you meant.
Yes.
Dangerous.
Yes. Yes.
Hi. Thanks a lot. Very interesting. I sort of go back to the time, and you were talking about this came out of the early gestation of Channel 4, and I think what's really important to remember is that, I was born when there was only one channel, and then I kind of vaguely remember two, and then three, and then Channel 4 came along, so it's this huge revolution, and then since that time, there's been this huge pluralism, channels coming out everywhere, channels on every day, every night. And I think what was really interesting about this was the impact that it had was precisely because there weren't all these channels that we watch now. It was just, it had this fantastic impact. It was punk television. It was fantastic.
It was punk television. That's precisely what it was. It was great. And the explosion was about to happen. And we predicted it in the film at Network 23, which now just doesn't seem enough. It should be, Network, 2003, but it seemed incredible that it was exploding at an unbelievable rate and something was about to happen.
I mean, the other thing, of course, is that in the world of the film you're about to see, there are far fewer brands. In fact, we imagined there were one or maybe two or maybe three brands. The Zigzag Corporation does everything from cars to soft drinks to, everything. So a much more homogenised world, which, again, I think is what we're moving towards.
Yeah. When we made the film, of course, there was no CCTV everywhere, and there were no cell phones, there was no internet.
We were lucky to have cameras.
Yeah. Shot on something called film.
Yeah, film. Anybody remember film? Man over there.
Actually, two questions. To the artists and to George, I'd like to ask if you can name the artists, your three most influential artists or cartoonists, and George, your three most influential sci-fi writers. And the second question, Back to the Future, and you know, which had that scene in the cafe with the Max Headroom. Just out of pure interest of copyright and this and that, how did Zemeckis approach you? Was it seen as fair use? Was there fair use? What were the ins and outs of the negotiations?
There's a lot of questions.
I don't really know. I mean, he must have just approached, you know, the owners of at the time.
Who were HBO?
It was
Lorimar, by then.
Lorimar.
Warner Brothers. Chrysalis.
There were a lot of people involved.
Uh-huh.
It got very common. The more popular it got, somehow, the more.
The more lawyers attached.
The more lawyers. Yeah.
More lawyers, like great in great clouds, they were clustering around.
I'd like to answer just that first question about influences, because I remember very strongly when we originally went to New York. We first went to New York in 78, I think it was, around about 77, 78. We were taken by the fact that the talking head was so unbelievably prevalent and it had so much impact on TV. And we were really curious about the way the face, the human face, would make a personal connection with you, the audience, that English TV didn't seem to have. It seemed to be speaking broadly to a
presenting,
whole
as opposed
whole
to
audience.
Engaging.
Yeah, and so that was, I think that really captivated us, so that was where the talking head became very much part of the kind of the culture. It was an icon already in our minds that was something that was going to be, you know, was going to be a big influence.
Americans have no shame in their commercials. American ads and British ads are very different, because America, they literally come straight at you, and it's, this is the product and this is why it's great for you, you know,
and it's
you. So there's a straight from the screen to the living room.
Yeah,
there's
you can see it. It's very prevalent in Fox News shows like Sean Hannity and Bill O'Reilly. Telling people what to think, really.
And
yeah,
the format's
exactly,
the same. It's still the same, and that whole business with Max, with him talking to one camera and then just turning and talking to the next camera, still do it.
And just in terms of general art,
I'd say Richard Hamilton, you know, as I was saying, the creature with the atom brain came from one of his sketchbooks, and you know, the pop artists at the time were a great influence to me anyway, you know, from Warhol to, you know, everyone really.
And I also think that we were one of the first generation of animators to, because that's what we were in the early days. That's we graduated as animators. We were the first people when we started off Cucumber. It was pre-MTV days, where our influences were not other animation companies or animators, on the whole, other than loving Tex Avery.
Yeah.
We really looked more to painters, and we were, you know, painters that particularly always seemed to appear in our, all that were stuck on our blackboards were things like Egon Schiele and Francis Bacon, and it was a more painterly influence than it was animation and cartoonists.
Who actually has the Max Headroom head and suit now?
There were lots of them.
They
fell apart quickly. Yeah.
They're all on eBay now.
They're all.
You'll find them on eBay.
One thing I was looking at when we showed that was the last video show that we did, and Max, in that show, he was looking back at the other 12 shows that had been created. Everybody was wearing sunglasses in all the videos, everywhere. Wasn't it incredible?
But the reason why we had to put sunglasses on Max was because he had these special contact lenses made for him, and I recall Matt Frewer was, you know, his eyes were absolutely burning up after a while, so he devised, oh, well, then he has to wear Ray-Bans just to give his eyes a rest.
An accidental icon once again.
Yep. So, how are we doing, Debbie?
Okay. Well, I'm going to answer the other question which came there about science fiction writers. Obviously,
Philip K. Dick.
Obviously, Philip K. Dick. Obviously, Philip K. Dick. And
if you want to look into it into any more detail, have a flick through Flow My Tears, the policeman said, because great artists steal, and there's a considerable amount from there. But I think if you're going to nick from somebody, nick from Dick. It's the best advice.
And 23 is a very and relevant, ongoing.
Of course, yeah.
Numeral.
Yeah, paranoia. I mean, Bill Burroughs, 23 Skidoo, Captain Clark, and all the stuff around that. The reason Network 23 is called Network 23 is to make the conspiracy theorist believe there actually really is a conspiracy. There is no conspiracy. I absolutely guarantee there is no conspiracy. I absolutely guarantee there is absolutely... So, yeah. And Bill Burroughs, of course, who was... this is William Burroughs, who did, who wrote Naked Lunch and everything. He was doing wonderful experiments in what are now called non-linear narratives by a whole bunch of academics who imagine they've just discovered this for the first time. Bravo. In point of fact, a man with a tape recorder in Tangier was doing the same thing in the late 60s and early 70s. And for future reference for anybody taking notes, nothing here but the recordings. Is the thing to listen to, and it's Bill Burroughs experimenting with scratch audio before there was even cassette tapes, and damnably interesting. Any further questions? Si.
I was just amazed.
I am still amazed by your predictions of the future, but I'm still waiting for the one person news hound that goes out with a camera and breaks the corporation's balls. I'm still waiting for that to happen.
We're working on that. We've got some interns, even as we speak, out there trawling. But what's news, really? Is a question I'll chuck back at you. What is news?
I trust my news input from Radio 4 and nothing else at the moment. Which is, but even that's wrong, you know.
Yeah.
But,
why do we know what we know? Who's in charge? I mean, I'm not suggesting there's anything sort of ulterior, there's ulterior motives or a sort of dark agenda here, but I would say there are ulterior motives here and a dark agenda.
There's a boardroom behind everything these days.
Yeah, I mean, what we know and how we know it is very much a part of a control mechanism. We went stamping off to war in Iraq because of information. I mean, controlling that is very much a part of it, and as Rocky said earlier, there is definitely a collusion between the military-industrial complex and the news thing. It's all the same thing. It's a facet of the same, the same kind of thing. So anything that we can do that helps us understand that these things aren't discrete, that they're all the same, is a help. So that, I guess, was part of our purpose, really. That and the overthrow of society as we know it. Anything else?
Hiya. I was a big fan of the show when I was a teenager, and we used to spend lots of time looking at it and trying to figure out how you did these things. It's like we knew it was fake, but we didn't know how it was fake in some way. It was completely fascinating to us. So what did Matt Frewer do? Did he improvise a lot? Did you play around a lot?
Yeah, he
did.
He embodied it. He brought it to life. He put breath of life into the character. Up until that point, you know, it was just an idea on paper. And And it's funny, as soon as we cast him, and we cast here, and we cast in America, because we wanted him to have an American accent, because we wanted it to have this kind of American kind of quality to it. And we found him in Canada, and he had this sort of Jim Carrey kind of witty, you know, kind of improv sort of aspect to him. And as soon as he put the makeup on, he just, like, he exploded into life.
Well, he created
up until that point, he was, like, really good. But then he put the makeup on, and for some reason, that mask enabled him to really transcend the character and create something completely new out of the character that we
created. But also, because he'd been influenced, obviously, by North American TV. And,
he knew all the cliches, all the insane American cliches that...
It was part of his language. I mean, it's very interesting. Not many actors actually act in masks. I mean, this takes us back to sort of Greek tragedy and all the rest of it, you know. So we were actually using that tradition too, you know, which is...
I thought it was incredible the way
whole technique of repeating of fractured images and stuff like that, the illusion wouldn't have worked, because actually, you know, you can see with the mouth, you can see that there are gestures of the human, and they break through. And it's only because of your film technique, you know, that fractured way, and all that kind
all
of...
All the editing and the...
Editing and, you
the
know,
lighting.
Sort of
the lighting was really important.
You know, a pretense at poor technology and, you know, the problems on things that it actually worked. If it was just him and a talking head, it wouldn't have, you know. So, I mean, to say that how much is actor, how much are filmmakers...
Well, it's a combination, but he did bring it to life.
You know, statistically, I see it much more as a, you know, as a piece of filmmaking than actually an acting thing.
Well, it was treated like animation in as much that once we'd shot it, we edited out every other frame, so that, like animation is done on a budget, it's normally 12 drawings a second, whereas normally in live action it would be 24 frames or 24 drawings if it was done as full animation like they did at Disney. But we treated it like animation by editing out every frame and then...
Repeating
that frame twice, which made it look somehow like animation, and you didn't quite know why. So it was a coming together of so many different aspects that then created the illusion.
And now you can get the self-same effect just by owning a digibox.
Yeah. Instagram.
Instagram, yeah, exactly. I mean, the Max Headroom effect is there now on your set-top box and TV.
But it's kind of great that it took all that money to make something look really cheap.
Yes. If we'd have had more, we would have made it look even cheaper.
So I wanted to ask a question about, well, sort of two questions related to the technology that was available to you at the time. And the first is, you used the word download when you were describing the backstory to Max's character, which is a word that we're all completely familiar with now, but we'd been, you know, no one would have heard that in the early 80s. Very, you know, well, certainly not as much. So the first question is, how much did available technology influence the creation of the show? And the second is, to what extent did it, did that affect how you, the look of it and your production process?
Can I have the first half of that? Mm-hmm. At the time, there was a great deal of talk about what was called then fifth generation, and this was something that was meant to be coming out of Japan. And this was going to be real artificial intelligence, and the Japanese were making breakthroughs with bubble memory and all kinds of stuff. So, there was also a great deal of research being done. At MIT with Marvin Minsky and all the AI groups, and I don't know if you ever came across. There's a program called ELIZA, which was one of the first. It's a transactional analysis program where you type something in and the program comes back at you and it says, why do you feel this way, etc. And we all found it incredibly interesting that even though this was a really noddy program, just a few lines of text, you could type in a word and it would say, why do you feel like this, back at you. And people became quite attached to it. They felt as though they were conversing with something. And this was an interesting idea. So the ideas about artificial intelligence, the ideas about computing and what computing is going to do, were very much germinal at the time. We didn't have the hardware, but all the thinking had actually been done 10 or 15 years before. You look at Norbert Wiener and cybernetics and all of that stuff, talks about talking about feedback systems. All the theory was there. What we're seeing now in the 21st century is just those theories actually being made concrete, you know, but it goes back a considerable way.
The technology at the time, you mean the visual technology, what was that happening with CGI at the time?
There was obviously, you were stimulating lighting effects.
Yeah.
And you're simulating the kind of the modelling
right.
capabilities. But obviously you weren't able to do that. And I'm wondering where that line is between stuff that you had to make up because it didn't exist
yeah. yet
and stuff that you made up that looked a bit like stuff that would have been massively expensive to produce.
Well, we used to go to a thing called SIGGRAPH in America, which was the CGI kind of conference every year. And it would have actually been possible to have created this image as a full-colour 3D model back then. But the computer power needed to have done that. I mean, we did talk to the Institute of Technology in New York, and it would have taken
4 days of frame.
Yeah, much more than that, probably. Mm. And they were using downtime from the banks in Manhattan, the number crunching computers that they used in Wall Street, the downtime to crunch numbers to do computer graphics for the Institute. So we did investigate that, and it would have cost a fortune, but it would have been kind of almost possible. I mean, in those days, we'd go to this SIGGRAPH thing, and I think it was like in Chicago or somewhere, and there'd be about as many people as in here, and this would be the whole world of CGI would be in this room, and they would show an image of a teapot, fully rendered teapot, just turning like that, and everybody would be on their standing round of applause. An incredible achievement, which it was, and like the early days of ray tracing, and but everything had this kind of plastic look, and I knew that that's where the image needed to go. We needed to make this human face with prosthetics, but we need to light it and make it look like it was made of some kind of digital plastic.
Well, New York Institute of Technology had a character that they had in fact created called User Friendly. I don't know whether we'd created a book at the same time called Creative Computer Graphics, which was all the sort of rudimentary early days of computer graphics. So this is a coffee table book, and on the front cover was User Friendly, thankfully given to us by NYIT, New York Institute of Technology, who was probably as close to Max Headroom visually as we could relate to it at that point, to say, okay, here's our sort of prototype, but it would be impossible to have a half-hour show with this character or something similar, introducing music videos. Even if he was only talking for 10 minutes, it would take months to do it. The character itself, User-Friendly, was a great prototype and inspiration.
And then interestingly, the lines behind him, they were computer-generated. And when we created the character, it was against a green screen background. We thought, what can we put behind him, And then we thought, well, that we need some sort of thing that also emphasised the computer technology aspect of it. And wouldn't it be cool if it was a computer-generated image? And simple linear animation was readily available at the time. And we, breathing life. Well, it comes to, what is consciousness, and can you recreate the consciousness of a human being? What actually is that, Yeah, I mean, that's the science fiction notion. I mean, we're, 12 billion neuron brain, that's not that many. I mean, is it possible to recreate that in a computer?
Well, it'll be possible to image it. I mean, if anybody's ever seen a Curlian photographs are those things of the hand, and they've kind of got a cloud around them. I think that we'll be able to analyse the field that's around everybody's head in a great deal more detail quite soon, and actually get the individual values. And that's part of what the notion is of capturing a human consciousness and being able to transfer it into computer. In order to capture it in the first place, you need to draw a map of it, and the map needs to be at a really good resolution. Does that make sense? I don't know if that makes sense or not. It's very dangerous.
There's an exhibition on at the Welcome at the moment, which has a large chunk to do with mapping brain.
Uh-huh.
Interesting.
The exhibition as a whole.
Okay.
I was just saying, there's an exhibition on at the Welcome at the moment, mm-hmm. which is all about the anatomy of the brain. So mm-hmm. they don't go into consciousness at all. Yeah. It's purely about physiognomy.
Yeah.
But what's going to be interesting from that, of course, is that we're starting to analyse people as they think, aren't we? And we're looking at different parts of the brain that fires up as different words and different and we say different phrases. And we're going to get to a point where we can know the words that someone is thinking, and they don't even have to utter them, and we'll be able to image that. And if we're able to image it, then here comes the scary bit, kids. We'll be able to implant it too, because if we can receive it with a certain frequency, then we can transmit as well. So it'll be a two-way process. Soon we won't need eyes, which is interesting. Anything? Yeah, but they cheated. They cheated. Big Blue cheated, because Kasparov was unable to go away and reprogram himself each night. And they reprogrammed Big Blue every night, which is why I believe it. Well, I mean, it's what happened. I don't know for sure, but it's part of a propaganda put about by a disgruntled IBM employee that's what happened in fact. That it wasn't a closed box, they were messing with it on each occasion.
Cheating.
Cheating. People have been known to cheat before. Do we have any?
I think the question I would like to ask is, how did the bands or the artists that appeared on the Max Headroom show feel about Max Headroom? Did you ever get any feedback from any of those guys at the time? Flattered to be involved with him, or were they? Because there were quite a lot of egos involved. I just wondered if, you know, Max became bigger than all of them put together, really, and still.
I think Sting got a bit irritated at one time.
Yeah, we did one interview with Sting on the you know, at the end. That was about it, really.
Well, all Max would talk about was his shoes.
Sting wanted to talk about rainforest.
He just insulted him.
Just wanted to say rainforest, shoes. It was.
It's funny. I don't know whether you're aware of a show in America called the Stephen Colbert Show, but. That, in a way, sort of embodies the sort of modern version of Max Headroom, and that kind of irreverent, you know, masking himself as an extreme right-wing kind of Aryan male, you know, but in actual fact his heart's in another place and just being very satirical. It's very similar to how Max's persona. But the bands, no, they didn't hear anything from the bands, did we? I mean, they're in their own world, aren't they? That's like,
they're just happy to be on TV.
Yeah, getting the exposure.
If anybody's got any explanation for musicians, I'd like to hear it. That's a good one. Yes, please, later, though. any further? Or?
Actually, just remind me that my friends used to go around saying,
Sting. Yeah, exactly. Well, I mean... We're all here. Everybody's got a remote control, so you can fuck with the picture if you like. If you just look under your seats, you'll see that you've got a remote control, just so it's plenty familiar. Shall we get into,
we should into the film.
Running this film?
Yeah, well, I think maybe on that note, please join me in thanking all our speakers for a really, really interesting conversation. Thank you.